I am the very model of a modern major general. I've information, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and the coast of Fichus Tartical, from Marathon to Waterloo in order categorical. I am very well acquainted too with matters mathematical. I understand equations, both the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorem, I am teeming with a lot of news. With many joyful facts about the square and the hypotenuse. I am very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings animalculous. In short, in method vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern major general.
Hello, I'm Julie Halston, and I'm really pleased to be part of Chartwell Booksellers' 40th anniversary reading series. The story of Winston Churchill's life away from politics is, for a performer like me, as compelling as the more familiar narrative of his epic political career. The lesson of that life is in the way it expanded with every setback. Each time Churchill was beaten and driven from political office, he found solace by burnishing his inner life, either by pursuing painting as a pastime, embarking as a writer on something new, or remaking an old house into a refuge called Chartwell. I'm going to read the foreword and a few pages from the best book ever written about Chartwell Booksellers' namesake, Winston Churchill's Chartwell Home in the Kent Countryside, Churchill and Chartwell by Stephan Bucczacki. While it is generally known that Winston and Clementine Churchill owned a property called Chartwell and that it was their home for 40 years, the fact that they also owned, rented, or borrowed many other houses is largely unappreciated. When I first set about researching what I expected to be the Chartwell story, therefore, it soon became evident that I too needed to know what had gone on before and who and what had influenced them. Why did they move so often and sometimes own two or three properties at the same time when at others they owned none? Who and what were the driving forces in deciding where they would live? How were the houses paid for? Why and when did Churchill take up farming and equestrian enterprises? And how did the family's pattern of domestic life relate to Churchill's political career? It also became evident that while much of the information I needed was certainly in the public domain at the Churchill archives, it had in large measure remained hidden because the bits that interested me were those that other biographers had ignored. And they were usually the bits that had been left out when the documents and the letters were published. I soon reached three decisions. First, I would read all the relevant Churchill papers as original documents. Second, where I had unavoidably to rely on secondary information, I would be circumspect in trusting any facts or comments that were neither in Sir Martin Gilbert's official biography nor written by members of the Churchill family. And third, I would endeavor to visit all of the Churchill's homes, official and private, long and short term, owned and rented, as well as those significant friends who influenced them. I had thought that being a lifelong admirer of Churchill might prove a handicap as I unfolded layer by layer a side to the man that was essentially unknown. Would I be disappointed and discover private feet of clay as this greatest of world statesmen dealt with estate agents, managed his mortgage, kept an eye on the grocer's accounts, chose wallpaper, argued with architects, hired and fired servants, developed his garden, and haggled with builders? On the contrary, I discovered an unexpected humanity. And while these letters, I certainly came to know the Churchill the world knows, a man born to lead, An ever impatient and often intolerant man, aware of his own destiny, a driven politician with an ego the size of a tank, I also found a gentler individual with human frailties and a measure of insecurity, and always loving, if not always caring, husband and above all, a man of total integrity. To my surprise, in the house-owning, homemaking, garden-building Churchill of my study, I found a bit of every man. The first time Churchill saw Chartwell, he was captivated by the setting, and only 6 miles to the northeast of their old home, Lulenden. The property lies at its highest point at just over 650 feet above sea level on the east-facing slope of a narrow valley running through the North Downs. In 1921, the house itself was usually referred to as Chartwell Manor and was still called the Manor by employees until recently. And even after its 19th century rebuilding had no great architectural merit. In truth, it was still a dismal looking pile, but it did offer a spectacular view across the Weald of Kent. And it was a view that possessed Churchill. He said that for its size, the site was the most beautiful and charming he had ever seen. On the opposite side of the valley was a magnificent bank of beech trees, Clementine's heavenly tree-crowned hill. Now largely gone, and the view today gives an inadequate impression of what Churchill saw in 1921. Knight Frank and Rutley held the initial auction of the Chartwell estate in 23 lots at the Rose and Crown Hotel in Tunbridge on Tuesday, the 26th of July, 1921. The intention was to sell it as a whole, except for a few parcels of land. The lots that interested Churchill were lot number one, which comprised mansion and grounds amounting to 79.435 acres, and lot number two, arable field and woodland, of 12.164 acres. Churchill responded to Knight, Frank, and Rutley's price of £5,500 with an offer of £4,800, a price he considered justified because the house would have to be largely rebuilt and there was dry rot in the north wing. 5 days later, he increased his offer to £5,000, and this was accepted immediately. Clementine, however, was still in the dark, and she remained so a few days later when Randolph, Diana, and Sarah were taken by their father on a mystery ride in the country. Churchill told them he was thinking of buying a country house, and they were being taken to see it and, you know, give their impressions. Oh, it was magical. They adored it, finding it mysterious and overgrown. Churchill kept asking them, oh, do you really like it? The children were delirious. Oh, do buy it, they said. Churchill said he wasn't sure, and it was not until they had arrived home that he had confessed. It was effectively his already. Any hopes, however, that the children's delirium would be mirrored by their mother would soon evaporate. Clementine was quite simply appalled. In the 14 months since she had first seen Chartwell and had turned the matter over and over in her mind, its defects had almost totally supplanted any virtues. She could see the spiraling costs and the anguish, the inheritance evaporating, the commitments in staff, time and heartache ever growing. It would be Lulenden magnified many times, and to a large degree. Oh, she was proved right. The purchase of Chartwell revealed Churchill at his most implacable, his most egotistical, his most deaf and blinkered to outside reason and influence. Chartwell possessed Churchill. As he possessed Chartwell, and as the years went by, and even when in due time Clementine was to soften her views, largely as their disposable income and means to pay increased, it remained a feature of their lives that served to unite and divide them in equal measure. There isn't a single date on which it can be said the Churchills took up residence at Chartwell. There wasn't one arrival date with furniture van in the modern fashion. They stayed there for odd days and weekends in what Tilden used to call a sort of picnicky way, well before the house was finished. And the first recorded guest in the visitor's book was Clementine's brother-in-law, Bertram Romilly, on 5th of January, 1924. By the summer, visitors were becoming more regular. Goony Churchill stayed for the first time on the 28th of June, Nellie Romilly, Clementine's sister, on August 3rd, and then over the 18th and 19th of August, Churchill's cousin, Freddie Guest, Lloyd George and the deputy chief of the naval staff, Sir Roger Keyes, and Churchill's former private secretary at the Colonial Office, the MP and ally of Lloyd George, Sir Archibald Sinclair, were all there discussing the likelihood of a general election being held in the autumn. Jack Churchill brought his son, Peregrine, for the first time a week later. The visitor's book isn't infallible, but it does offer a valuable record of people who were at the house overnight to dine and sleep, as Clementine's diary put it. Day visitors weren't usually recorded. It could probably be said, however, that the family's real occupation dated from just about Easter 1924, when Churchill himself moved in, although Clementine wasn't there officially to cross the threshold with her husband. She was with her sister and brother-in-law visiting her mother, who was by then getting very old and feeble. So Churchill took possession of his house alone, perhaps appropriately. It was his discovery, his project, his house, and it was to be some years before Clementine truly saw it as a shared venture with which she genuinely felt at ease. On Maundy, Thursday, 17th of April, 1924, Churchill wrote his first letter from Chartwell, the first of many thousands to come, letters that were to chart the course of English history over the next half century. Appropriately, correctly, it was to Clementine. "This is the first letter I have ever written from this place, and it is right that it should be to you." Happy anniversary, Chartwell Booksellers.